have a few announcements to bring to your attention. First of all, happy birthday to Lila Parkinson on the 28th of February and to Norma Regno on February the 29th. Also, a huge thank you to all of you who organized and served at the show Tuesday Supper on February the 21st. It was a great, great evening, and we're so glad that so many came out, and we're so glad that so many thought to have this and did it. It was lovely. Also, next Sunday, we're very blessed in this congregation to have a number of volunteers to take and conduct worship services every now and then here. I'm so grateful. I know other churches will say, who are we going to get? If the minister's going to be away, who are we going to get? And we have volunteers here, and this is fantastic. But then we want to add to the list, Reverend Jean LaBeouf. He has been here different times as guest speakers, and he said, Alice, let me take a service for you sometime. And so March, next Sunday, Jean should be here to take the sermon. So we're very, very grateful. He'll give me a chance to do some other things that when I'm busy preparing services, that give me the opportunity to get some other things done. So we're very grateful for that. Also, please take note that the last Sunday of March is the annual meeting after the church service. So if you have reports, which I have not got done yet, which I hope to get done this week, it'd be good to get them in. I believe that those are all the announcements to be brought to your attention. Let us come together in our gathering song as we sing from hymn number 108 in Voices United, verses 1-3.
Thank you.
us come together in prayer as it is printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have brought us to this season of Lent, this time of preparation for crucifixion and resurrection. Give us courage so to examine ourselves, to be honest about who we are and to what we are called, that we might meet the joy on Easter morning, our risen Savior, to whom with you and the Spirit, one holy God, be honor and praise, now and forever. We join together in your name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. In the Advent season and the Lenten season, we have a candle ceremony, and the members of the Bergeron family this morning are going to lead us in the Lenten candle liturgy.
There are many temptations we face in our lives together. We face the temptation of putting our wants above others' needs. We face the temptation of ignoring problems such as hunger, poverty, war, and disease with the false hope that they will go away without our intervention. We face the temptations of wealth and consumerism. We face many temptations to stray from the path of our faith.
We light this candle as a symbol of our faith in Jesus Christ to help us resist the temptations of the world.
We pray. Lord, help us to keep our feet moving, our hands outstretched, and our hearts open to you as we journey towards the cross this Lenten season. Keep us from temptation and help us to do your work in our world. Amen.
Thank you.
know how to do it now, but you know, maybe sometimes you say, I don't know how to tie my shoelaces. Can you help me, please? Or I don't know how to open this key in the door. Or different things like that. Could you please help me to know how to do that? And so we ask somebody that knows how to do it to help us, right? Well, this morning, I brought along a recipe book. You know, and sometimes we look at recipes and we go, oh, wow, that looks so good, but I don't know how to do it. And so there's instructions. So that, you know, like peel the potatoes or peel the carrots or stuff like that. And if you put them in the oven to cook before you make soup, don't forget to take them out before they burn. Some people do that. I shouldn't be looking at him because it's me that did, okay? But he was helping me take the burnt parts off before I made the soup, and then he didn't want to eat the soup because it looked so bad. All right. But anyway, so sometimes we need help, right, in doing things the right way. And that's one reason why we come to church, isn't it? And why we read the Bible. Because Jesus tells us that it's a good thing to love other people, to take good care of other people, to be helpful, to be kind. And sometimes we think, I don't really know how to do that very well. And so we look to other people, maybe grandma and grandma and moms and dads, different things like that, or other people in the church say, please show me how to love as Jesus loves. And we also read the Bible because Jesus shows us the way he lives and how to love other people. And we need a lot of love in this world, taking care of other people, right? So God can use us that way, and he shows us how. So it's great to have you guys here in church this morning. And, you know, maybe mom and grandpa and great-grandpa, I see great-grandparents here this morning, welcome, you know, to show us how to love as Jesus loves. So, okay, that's it. So we're going to sing this morning, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God, 356, and then you children will go down with Mrs. Bergeron and Mrs. Lane for Sunday school, okay? 356.
Of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat it, you shall die. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some of it to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The next reading is from Matthew 4, verses 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, 'One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.'" Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve only him.'" Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Blessed be the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Sandra. Well, here we are, with it once again being the first Sunday of Lent, those 6 weeks prior to Easter Sunday. The word Lent is not mentioned in the Bible. It was established later in the early church as a time to recall Jesus' journey to the cross. And as we know from some denominations, it became a time of fasting, of giving up certain likes, mostly having to do with food. And it became a time of focusing on where we as humans have gotten off course in terms of our relationship with God, and what it cost the Lord to come to earth as a human being. And so today, as we come to worship, compared to the festivities of pre-Christmas, with colorful lights and trees going up, and parties and gift giving, and joyful Christmas songs, even on the radio, coming to Lent, we may think, Lent? Because we're not celebrating a beautiful little baby being born, but rather towards the end of Lent, we're remembering an innocent, loving man going to a cross for us. So no wonder we want to get in on the more secular bandwagon of this season and start thinking of bunnies and chickens and chocolate. Lots of chocolate. And as we enter the Lenten season, though, can I present a little different perspective that may help us to see Lent in a more positive light? You'll notice that I've titled these reflections, On the Road to Victory. When we think of victory, particularly when it's to our advantage, that's positive, right? When we're at war, we want to have the victory. When we're playing some sports game, we want to win. If we've caught a disease, we want to win, to have victory over it. Well, as we go into Lent, this pre-season of Easter and journey towards the cross, we know that Jesus was engaged in a battle for us, and the outcome was he won. The well-known writer G.K. Chesterton one time remarked that the gospel is the good news of original sin. Christian writer Gerald Kennedy said Mr. Chesterton had a point, and it is necessary for us to keep clear in our minds that we believe in something that certainly does not shut its eyes to the tragedy and pain of living. He said we must not forget that the symbol we go by is the cross, which means crucifixion and suffering. But the rejoicing comes when we understand that it was this cross that brought to us the knowledge of the love of God and of his concern for all people forever. And so today, as the beginning of study of this season, Sandra has read the familiar account of Jesus going into the wilderness and being tempted. The word temptation is quite a negative word for us too, isn't it? We rightfully associate it with the desire to do something that is not to our benefit and that we really want to do. We're tempted when we're most vulnerable. For example, if we're trying to lose weight, we're really tempted to have that second or third piece of favorite dessert, right? If we're gamblers, we want to keep on gambling. We might just win this time. We're tempted to have that next drink that we know will be over the limit. But hey, it tastes good. Why not have another one? One for the road. We're tempted to cheat maybe on the exam when we're not prepared to write it. I recall as a youngster having a spelling test in our little one-room school. You know, when you're little, the print is big, so you can look over and see what other people are printing. So I looked over the next student's paper and saw that that student had spelled barn a different way than what I had spelled it. And so I wrote it his or her way. Well, you may have guessed that student had spelled it the wrong way. So the list of temptations can go on and on where we feel most vulnerable. And often, we're sorrier for having given in. However, in preparing for this service, I came across this perspective from Dr. William Barclay, renowned Bible scholar from some time ago, and he writes, "What we call temptation is not meant to make us sin. It is meant to enable us to conquer sin. It is not meant to make us bad. It is meant to make us good. It is not meant to weaken us. It is meant to make us emerge stronger and finer and purer from the ideal." You know, we've had something really strong and we did it. And so he writes, "Temptation is not the penalty of being a man. Temptation is the glory of being a man. It is the test which comes to a man whom God wishes to use. So then we must think of this whole incident and experience of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness, not so much as the tempting as the testing of Jesus." not so much the tempting as the testing of Jesus. Did you catch that? Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross to defeat death and to enable us to come back to God who is love. He needed to pass this test. Because his tempting goes back to the creation story of Adam and Eve, and they're giving in to the temptation of not obeying God, their creator, and therefore bringing death to the world. I expect that many of us have problems maybe with the reality of there actually being an original Adam and Eve, especially if they taught the theory of evolution with no God in the story. But the theory of evolution without God is just that. It's a theory. There are many loopholes for that saying that there is no God and that it just all came to be. There are so many loopholes. And I'm not going to get into that today, but suffice to say today that there is adequate evidence for there being a creator. There is evidence for him being a God of love. That there is much brokenness and pain in this world that gives credibility to something happening that created disunity between God, God of love, and his creation, especially humans. And so if we think of temptation as being a test, might we see how Adam and Eve, whom Sandra also read about, failed that test? They gave in. They gave in to that test. But Jesus was a perfect human being, as Adam and Eve originally were, and in order for him to fully bring us life again, he needed, unlike Adam and Eve, the first perfect human beings who failed the test, he needed to have the victory in these temptations. And so St. Matthew and St. Luke say the evil one, the devil, tempted Jesus at his most vulnerable points, the way he will tempt us at our most vulnerable points. And with Jesus in his hunger, after not eating for 40 days, he was tempted to use the power that he had to satisfy himself by turning stones into bread. He was tempted to seek attention by throwing himself off a high point of the temple and letting the angels rescue him. He was tempted to seek to have power over the world by bowing in tribute to the devil, who was claiming to have the world under his control. And in none of these temptations, though, did Jesus give in to the devil. Each time, Jesus standing strong in his commitment to follow his Father God, he knew the truth of God's love. And he stuck to that. He was not dissuaded from who he was or from God's love and God's desire for him and for the world. And so, in doing so, he won one of his battles on the road to victory, both for himself and us. As Dr. Barclay noted, in resisting the temptations, the Lord has shown his glory of being the man. And if we were highly excitable and emotional people, I see you sitting there so quiet and listening, thank you. But if we were just so emotional and thinking about this and realizing this, you know, we might cheer and say, yay, Lord, you know, he won over those battles. But since we are very self-contained and low-key, we can still mutter a quiet, thank you, God, for winning those battles. And so in this text, we can take encouragement, can we not? How often do we feel overwhelmed by our own weaknesses? How often do we feel like we have no strength to overcome the things that pull us down? And we're not alone in this. Do you recall St. Paul, of all people, admitting his struggles and saying, "The good I want to do, I don't do. And what I don't want to do, I do." We want to say to St. Paul, "Hey, Paul, I hear you. Got the same problem. I said I wasn't going to do that anymore, but hey, I've done it again. Understand what you're going through." St. Paul continues on saying, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me eternity from this body of death. Can you feel his despair? And then he answers his own question. Who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Paul was recognizing that Jesus knows the deepest human temptations because he's experienced them and he's won over them. And there is help. There is help for us with ours. In the scripture passages that I listed in the bulletin this morning, there's a passage from Romans. But I asked Sandra not to read it. You can go home and read it yourself, okay? You'll understand why I asked Sandra not to read it, because Paul is a wonderful writer. He's a wonderful man. But he goes off in tangents, he goes on and on. You go, what is he talking about? He tried to figure and get through it, what he's saying. But basically, through the part that I asked Sandra not to read this morning, but you can read at home or here, basically he is saying, Jesus is the difference between Adam, in that Adam fell, but Jesus did not. As a writer pointed out, the great difference is that because of Adam, we are pronounced guilty. Because of Christ, we are pronounced not guilty. So this morning, folks, would you say that's good news? In the season of Lent, then, as we pause for worship, whether here or in our homes, let us remember that our Lord is here for us. He wants us to have victory over our struggles and temptations. And in following him, we are indeed on the road to victory. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us sing 40 days and 40 nights. 114 in Voices United. Verses 1, 2, 3, and 5.
Verse 1.
Only verse 1.
verse 1.
Only verse 1. 870 by his faith.
Oh,
together in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, our lives are so full of your goodness toward us that it's impossible to give you thanks for every evidence of your care. We take for granted the many miracles in our everyday lives, the love of family and community that sustains us, nourishment, physical and spiritual, that gives us strength to reach the potentials you set in each of us. We thank you for laughter and learning and for hugs. We are grateful for kindly deeds and opportunities both to give and receive. We are enriched by the many ways you reveal yourself in our experience. You are the eternal and patient Father of us all. You bring to us a heightened sense that we are also brothers and sisters to one another. So on this first Sunday in Lent, in which we turn our eyes once again toward the cross, we are overwhelmed with gratitude for Jesus and for all that he means to us and to our world. We thank you for the birth of Christ, for his incarnation in human flesh, for his ability to speak our language and to experience our pain and temptations. We thank you for the life of Christ, for the example of his actions, for the wisdom of his words, for his understanding of our human predicaments, for his expressions of compassion. We thank you for the death of Christ, for his willingness freely to sacrifice himself, for the unbelievable measures he took to save us, for the very pangs of hell he suffered on our behalf. We thank you for the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, and for his own promised coming again, for the assurance he gives of our own resurrection, and for the promise of eternal bliss. And we thank you, our Father, for all who take seriously our Lord's commission to take the gospel out into the world, to make disciples among all people, to make manifest among all the new being in life that was shown in Jesus. We especially thank you for our missionaries and all mission-minded persons, groups, and churches. You have raised up a worldwide people to be your church, to glorify your name and to do your work. And today may we stand as partners in making Jesus Christ known, loved, and obeyed among all people in our day. Lord, you know the desires of our hearts even before we utter them. But we have placed upon the altar some of our very special concerns. Now hear the earnest prayers of each of our hearts. Great physician for all those who are on our prayer list and whom we hold in our hearts. Touch with healing the sick whom we name in silence before you. Carpenter of Nazareth, sustain those whose work overwhelms and overburdens their strength, and those who despair of finding work to do. Son of Mary, guide those who are baffled by the problems of parenthood, and comfort those who yearn for loved ones far away. And O love that will not let us go, give to the lonely and the grieving that companionship that awakens faith's song. Lord God, thank you so much for your love. Again, we just don't take it all in sometimes, but when we think of it, we can be so overwhelmed with what you've done for us. Thank you. We lift up these prayers to you in your Son's name. Amen. Let us come together in our closing hymn today, The Way of the Cross Leads Home. It's number 50 in the Songs of the Gospel. And we are going to sing, right by both it, verses 1 and 2. And then verse 3 after the benediction. Thank you. hope that you can all join us downstairs for coffee and conversation and treats following this service. And now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. The blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.